I honestly don't like reading this chapter. Is that okay to say?
As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, "Look, I am sending my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way."
What's going on, everybody? Welcome to Branch Together. This is the channel where we read and reflect on one chapter of the New Testament every day. I'm one of your hosts here. I'm Darren. I'm a pastor in downtown Red Bank, New Jersey. And we love interacting with you all over the world each day here as we turn to God's Word. Now, this chapter is a little bit dicey. Paul says some things that are frustrating, hard to understand, and difficult to wrap our brains around. But that's okay. We're still going to be faithful and come to the Word and see what God can teach us today through our discussion and interaction with this. As always, since we believe that God still speaks today through His Word, we're going to turn to Him first in prayer before we open the Word. God, we humbly come to You now. Lord, we submit ourselves to You. We pray that Your Spirit guides us as we read this Word. I also pray, Lord, for everyone in this community, wherever we are around the world. I pray that You just speak life and encouragement, courage and strength into each of us today, Lord. I pray that You give us boldness to speak Your Word in our contexts and the love to do it graciously. In Your name we pray. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, and especially that you may prophesy. For the person who speaks in another tongue is not speaking to people, but to God, since no one understands him. He speaks mysteries in the Spirit. On the other hand, the person who prophesies speaks to people for their strengthening, encouragement, and consolation. The person who speaks in another tongue builds himself up, but the one who prophesies builds up the church. I wish all of you spoke in other tongues, but even more that you prophesied. The person who prophesies is greater than the person who speaks in tongues, unless he interprets so that the church may be built up. So now, brothers and sisters, if I come to you speaking in other tongues, how will I benefit you unless I speak to you with a revelation or knowledge or prophecy or teaching? Even lifeless instruments that produce sounds, whether flute or harp, if they don't make a distinction in the notes, how will what is played on the flute or harp be recognized? In fact, if the bugle makes an unclear sound, who will prepare for battle? In the same way, unless you use your tongue for intelligible speech, how will what is spoken be known? For you will be speaking into the air. There are, doubtless, many different kinds of languages in the world. None is without meaning. Therefore, if I do not know the meaning of a language, I will be a foreigner to the speaker, and the speaker will be a foreigner to me. So also you, since you are zealous for spiritual gifts, seek to excel in building up the church. Therefore, the person who speaks in another tongue should pray that he can interpret it. For if I pray in another tongue, my spirit prays, but my understanding is unfruitful. What then? I will pray with the Spirit, and I will also pray with my understanding. I will sing praise with the Spirit, and I will also sing praise with my understanding. Otherwise, if you praise with the Spirit, how will the outsider say amen at your giving of thanks, since he does not know what you are saying? For you may very well be giving thanks, but the other person is not being built up. I thank God that I speak in other tongues more than all of you. Yet in the church, I would rather speak 5 words with my understanding in order to teach others also than 10,000 words in another tongue. Brothers and sisters, don't be childish in your thinking, but be infants in regard to evil and adult in your thinking. It is written in the law, I will speak to this people by people of other tongues and by the lips of foreigners, and even then they will not listen to me, says the Lord. Speaking in other tongues, then, is intended as a sign, not for believers, but for unbelievers, while prophecy is not for unbelievers, but for believers. If, therefore, the whole church assembles together, and all are speaking in other tongues, and people who are outsiders or unbelievers come in, will they not say that you are out of your minds? But if all are prophesying, and some unbeliever or outsider comes in, he is convicted by all and is called to account by all. The secrets of his heart will be revealed, and as a result, he will fall face down and worship God, proclaiming, God is really among you. What then, brothers and sisters? Whenever you come together, each one has a hymn, a teaching, a revelation, another tongue, or an interpretation. Everything is to be done for building up. If anyone speaks in another tongue, there are to be only two, or at most three, each in turn, and let someone interpret it. But if there is no interpreter, that person is to keep silent in the church and speak to himself and God. Two or three prophets should speak, and the others should evaluate it. But if something has been revealed to another person sitting there, the first prophet should be silent. For you can all prophesy one by one, so that everyone may learn and everyone may be encouraged. And the prophets' spirits are subject to the prophets, since God is not a God of disorder, but of peace. As in all the churches of the saints, the women should be silent in the churches, for they are not permitted to speak, but are to submit themselves, as the law also says. If they want to learn something, let them ask their own husbands at home, since it is disgraceful for a woman to speak in the church. Or did the word of God originate from you, or did it come to you only? If anyone thinks he is a prophet or spiritual, he should recognize that what I write to you is the Lord's command. If anyone ignores this, he will be ignored. So then, my brothers and sisters, be eager to prophesy, and do not forbid speaking in other tongues. But everything is to be done decently and in order. Okay, so yeah, this chapter is tough because Paul's dealing with some issues in Corinth. And unfortunately, we don't know all the historical details around why this letter was written. There are a bunch of things in this letter to the Corinthians that are very clear and obviously useful for us today. But some other things are difficult and challenging for us to reconcile. Honestly, they make me want to rip my hair out sometimes, just trying to figure all of it out. For instance, without a doubt, your ears peaked when you heard the part where Paul says that women are to be silent. Now, this is not the main point of the chapter, but I feel like we have to address it and just talk about it for a minute, because it certainly caught my attention as I read. He says that women should be silent in churches, for they're not permitted to speak. Well, this is apparently in keeping with some law in that region. If you read the text, you see that. Now, the fact that there was actually a law discussing this idea here, precluding women from speaking in church altogether, it tips us off that this is probably there's probably some type of cultural implications here that we need to consider as we're thinking about this. There was a law of the land about this. But beyond that, we can't reconcile it, because if you look at the balance of scripture through the whole canon, it doesn't exactly paint a picture of women being silent in all Christian gatherings. Now, one reasonable understanding of this is that women were not educated in the things of the church, and if they wanted to learn something, they should learn it at home with their presumably better educated husbands. The women that were asking questions in church, if this is the case, were just making a scene because they weren't educated, didn't know what they were talking about, and causing trouble. This is the view held by Craig Keener and many other scholars, and I'm sympathetic to this because, like I said, if you look at the balance of scripture, it doesn't paint a picture of women always being silent in Christian gatherings. So yeah, I think he's dealing with an issue specific to Corinth, but let's put that on the shelf for now because, like I said, that's not the main point of this chapter. The main point of this chapter is that our gifts are to be used for the edification or the building up of the body of Christ. The example that runs through this chapter is speaking in tongues versus prophecy. This was probably also something going on in their church. They were fighting about, maybe they were obsessed with speaking in tongues, and Paul was saying, let me just point this out to you here, how they play off of each other. He says that speaking in tongues is great. Apparently, Paul himself did that more than most anyone else, so he says. But prophecy, that's even better. Now, he's not pitting these gifts against each other to create some rivalry in the church, but rather, he's trying to point out that there is an intrinsic value to some of these gifts that are more beneficial to the church than others. The last two chapters, we saw that the gifts were for every believer. I covered that in chapter 12. Then yesterday, we saw that whatever gift you have, if it is not used with love, it is useless. He says that your gift without love is like a clanging of a terrible, harsh cymbal. And now, in chapter 14, we see a continuation showing us that the most valuable aspects of our gifting are in what can be given back to the community. What is your opinion on speaking in tongues? It seems that Paul was comfortable encouraging believers to seek it along with the other gifts. But it also seems that Paul was telling us in this that it's not the most important thing. In this case, he's pointing out that prophecy is even better because of the benefits for the body of Christ, presumably not just the personal benefits one would get. Which gets me thinking. We should probably not just focus our prayers on asking God for things that edify ourselves, but rather for things that edify the body. Perhaps today we want to pause and ask God to help us grow in gifts that would build up the body. Gifts like teaching, administration, service, and maybe even prophecy. I hope you pause today and ask God to help you grow in your giftings so that they may be used to build up the church and the other believers around you. That's the heart of Paul's message today. In my heart for us today, that we grow in the gifts that God has given us for the edification of the church and the building of God's kingdom. We want to see his kingdom come here, and we're part of that. All right, well, that's all for today. That wraps up 1 Corinthians 14. Tomorrow, we have a special treat. We have a guest joining us from Jamaica. We'll meet him tomorrow. All right, love all you guys. Have a good day.